Today on Studio One, a snip of the scissors and you can have a brand new look. We'll spend a day in the life of someone who teaches others the art of hairstyling. Also, music and cruising go well together. We'll find out why some audio enthusiasts put more money into their car stereo than their car. And President Bush has stressed the importance of toppling the Iraqi regime. We'll talk with a man who used to be Saddam Hussein's advisor.
From the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, this is Studio One.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Studio One. I'm Monty Cashel.
And I'm Adria Ensrud.
Well, you saw some video just a little bit ago of someone helping others learn how to cut hair.
I did curlers.
Yeah. In that story, they talk a little bit about hairstyles coming and going and that sort of thing. Uh-huh. One of the more interesting hairstyles to come back recently is the mullet. I don't know if you know what that is or not.
I do. I've seen those. It's business in the front kind of a thing.
Short on the side, long at the back. It's a male. Yeah. Male haircut.
Yes. Now, did you ever sport one of those in the 80s?
That's confidential information.
I'm going to figure this out.
I can't tell you that. We'll look forward to that story. Also on Studio One, many students lack hands-on experience until they take a college internship. But we'll show you one high school that gives students the chance to take what they learn in the classroom and apply it to a real-life setting.
Also, in times of war, the job of the military recruiter can be stressful. Later, we'll talk to two recruiters who will tell us how their job has been affected.
Before we get to that, here's today's news with Haley Wamstead.
Thanks, Monty and Adria. Iraqis in the northern part of the country are showing their reaction to the fall of Saddam Hussein's regime. Citizens in Kirkuk demonstrated their feelings towards the Iraqi leader by toppling yet another statue of the former head of Iraq. The statue, which was located in the city's central square, showed Saddam dressed in a tribal robe. Kurdish leaders and U.S. Special Operations troops are now in control of Kirkuk, which is known as the oil capital of northern Iraq. Turkish leaders say they will not accept a permanent Kurdish presence in Kirkuk. While some Iraqis are celebrating the turnaround in Iraq, others are hunting for treasures in Baghdad. Looters went through the home of Prime Minister Tariq Aziz and took just about anything they could carry. Aziz was the primary spokesperson for the Iraqi regime leading up to the war. However, the home of Aziz wasn't the only place the Iraqis went through. Looters also ransacked other governmental buildings in Baghdad. The looters even went through hospitals, which is making it difficult for citizens who need medical care. Keeping in touch with U.S. soldiers overseas is getting more complicated. Many church groups and school children have overwhelmed the military with care packages and letters for the troops. In response, the Department of Defense is advising people that packages and letters intended for random troops will be refused. The problem with the packages is not knowing what's in them and the fear of anthrax. Many are turning to email to continue communication. The director of the Family Support Center at the Grand Forks Air Force Base in North Dakota says there are things people can do to support the troops.
We're emphasizing people to do things to the heartland, help families, phone cards, things that enhance communication and all that good stuff.
Some schools have started to fill up shoe boxes and bring them to nearby Air Force bases to be inspected. The bases can then seal them up and distribute them. The spokesman for the South Carolina National Guard says the troops are grateful for the support, but he warns the packages need to go through the process the Department of Defense has approved. In the latest James Bond movie, Agent 007 had an invisible car. And if one Japanese scientist had his way, Bond might have had a coat to match. Researchers at a Tokyo university have developed a coat that projects images from behind the wearer to the front of the garment. This specially designed hooded jacket uses projector lenses and microscopic reflectors. The technology makes the person wearing it appear see-through. The coat is still in the developmental phase, but scientists think it may have many potential uses, including aviation and military camouflage. Many schools only offer classes that require their students to sit and listen to their teacher's lecture. However, one school has a program that takes a different approach by sparking students' interest and allowing them to use their creativity. Many kids grumble at the thought of sitting behind a school desk all day. Teachers in this small town of Hatton, North Dakota, are trying to breathe new life into their school curriculum.
We felt that we needed to have something for them so that they could take some classes which met their interest and not just into the classroom setting.
The program is called School to Work. There's a construction class, one that involves working in a greenhouse, and another that has students writing for the town's weekly paper. Teachers say the electives force students to problem solve, be cost efficient, and improve such skills as responsibility and safety.
Poke from the bottom again and use this to handle them. Yeah, and anybody should, you know, get two of them in there. I think the biggest thing it does is it empowers kids. It gives them power. They are the ones that make or break what goes on out here. If they are going to be hopeless, then the business is going to fail.
Students in the greenhouse class work on the project from the very beginning of planting the seeds through all the steps of the business until they get their final product. The construction class, on the other hand, helped build the school's greenhouse. Students have also made portable fish houses, renovated two homes, and built an outdoor hockey rink in town.
We started out building the shed, so we started out the floor plans, and we moved up to the sides, and then we did the roof, and then the nailing and all that stuff, and then siding, we learned all that.
You know, their math and science, and they can carry that into this class, but that's what makes the schoolwork project so good.
While many students are planting flowers and sawing wood, others are down the hall typing up the town's weekly newspaper.
I'm writing my column for the Hatton Free Press, which is the local paper, and the school writes it, and I write a column.
The school hopes that by offering different electives that spark the students' interest, they are lending a hand in their futures to come. Before the School to Work program began, it was funded by the state through grants. But now, 8 years later, all three classes are supported by the money they earn from the projects the students make. And that's news for now. Monty and Adria.
Thanks a lot, Haley. Well, I'm sure that's not the only greenhouse that's seeing a lot of action lately. They're probably getting ready all over the place for the spring planting.
Spring, temperatures are rising, sun is shining. I'm pretty excited about that.
Me too.
Why don't we go check in with Nadine Schrader at the Regional Weather Information Center to see if those temperatures will continue.
Well, Monty and Adria, it looks as though the temperatures are going to stay up for the rest of the weekend. But before we get to that, let's take a look at our Grand Forks Almanac. Today we hit a high of 60 degrees is what we're currently sitting at. Our low was 35. It's hard to believe that yesterday our high was 73. We did have a cold front move through our area today to bring our temperatures back down. Our sun will set tonight at 8:11 p.m. Currently in Grand Forks, we are sitting at our high for the day of 60 degrees under sunny skies. Dew point at 34, relative humidity at 37%. It's a little breezy outside with northwest winds at 17 miles an hour and our pressure at 29.99 inches of mercury. Across our region, they are seeing well above average temperatures, especially in Fargo, 65 degrees, Billings, 67, beautiful temperatures down in North Platte, Nebraska at 72 degrees. Our surface analysis shows a high pressure system building back into our area that is going to keep our skies clear through overnight. This was the cold front that moved through throughout today that brought our temperatures back down from where they were yesterday. As we zoom out across the nation, we are seeing a low pressure system building up in the northwest corner that is going to bring some snow into the Washington and Oregon area overnight. And bigger story, on the southeastern corner of the states, we are seeing a low pressure system that's associated with quite a stir down there. They are having some flood advisories and winter weather watches. Tomorrow we are going to see a low pressure system drift up the coast, bring some rain towards the New York area and also some snow in the Appalachian Mountains. Tomorrow in our region, a high pressure system is working its way in again, along with a warm front to keep our temperatures up throughout the weekend. Tomorrow's forecast shows a high of 58 degrees, a low of 35. Mostly sunny skies, and we are going to see some scattered clouds come in through the afternoon hours. North to northeast winds at 5 to 15 miles an hour. Your Studio One Weather IQ question is, what does radar stand for? Your answers are A, named after its creator, B, rain detection and ranging, C, ranging Doppler and rays, or D, radio detection and ranging. Well, Monty and Adria, I'll have the answer to that question and the extended forecast coming up for you guys later in the show.
Thank you so much, Nadine.
All right. Do you have any idea what the answer would be?
I don't even know what that is, really. So
radar.
Not too good at those.
We'll have to figure that out by the time we get to weather again. Well, it's time now to go to sports with Corey Morlock.
Thanks, Monty and Adria. Dallas Stars goalie Marty Turco posted 1.72 goals against average in the regular season. However, the regular season ended last week, and this is the playoffs. Turco and the Stars hosted Edmonton in the first round Wednesday night. To the highlights, no score, middle of the first, Dallas Sedor shot from the point, Mike Modano picks up the rebound and puts it away, 1-0 Stars. Same score in the second, Ryan Smith with a baseball swing, trickles past Turco, ties it all up at one apiece. Midway through the second, Sean Horkoff gets a pass and blasts one off the pipe and in. beats Turco and the Oilers win 2-1. In baseball, Oakland at Texas, bases loaded, 2-1 A's, top fourth. Ramon Hernandez drives one through the infield into right field. Juan Gonzalez coming up throwing, doesn't get it there in time. Miguel Tejada and Durazo score 4-1 Oakland. Now 6-1, top five, one on. Miguel Tejada sails one away to left field. It's not coming back. A's would go up 8-1 and hold on to win 8-3. When many motorcyclists get on their bikes, they choose to ride without the protection of a helmet. That simple precaution could greatly reduce their chance of serious injury or death. Helmets save hundreds of lives each year. However, there are still people who choose not to use them. Less than half of all states require riders to wear a helmet. Helmets play a critical role in protecting riders from head and neck injuries. However, local motorcycle owners say helmets aren't only used during protection of a crash.
Extreme weathers that we do ride in to help protect the individual, rain, wind, gravel.
Anderson says wearing a helmet should be up to the riders themselves and not mandated by the states. Many riders who do not use helmets say wearing one makes it difficult to hear when riding a motorcycle. They also say helmets reduce peripheral vision, which could lead to more accidents. It's now time for the Studio One Sports Trivia question. What country has won the most World Cups ever? Is it Italy, France, Germany, or Brazil? We'll get the answer to that and more sports coming up in the second half hour of the show. Monty and Adria.
Thanks, Corey. Stay with us and we'll take a look at an award-winning book that is making its debut on the big screen. Holes, a Walt Disney picture, tells the story of one boy who is sent to camp in order to turn his life around.
And devoting yourself entirely to a military lifestyle is a serious commitment. Some choose to become only part-time soldiers. Coming up, we'll talk with two men who help people decide if military life is right for them.
University of North Dakota College of Business and Public Administration offers real degrees for real people. Our nationally recognized faculty can help you earn a master's degree in business through evening classes.
Taking these evening classes were very convenient for me, and that's how I was able to complete the program.
We offer degrees for people who work, raise families, and lead busy lives. The UND College of Business and Public Administration, real degrees for real people.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business with skills to enhance your workforce retention and productivity efforts. The UND Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in conducting employee satisfaction research, workforce needs assessments, and the development of customized training materials. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
The University of North Dakota. You can go anywhere from here. At UND, you'll find a challenging, exciting community that draws students from across the nation and around the world. Visit our campus and join the University of North Dakota community.
Explore the educational opportunities available through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota. With just one phone call or a click of the mouse, you'll find high-quality programs designed for today's adults. We have a large selection of continuing education courses that are available at a time and place that's convenient for you. Discover a world of learning through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
At UND Aerospace, let your future take flight. Plan your education in the most technologically advanced collegiate and contract aerospace training environment on the planet. Graduates work for top agencies and fly for every major airline nationwide. Study on campus, via distance learning, or at any of our facilities, and you'll be where the aviation industry leaders of tomorrow are today. UND Aerospace at the University of North Dakota, Grand Forks.
You're watching Studio One, news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
U.S. National Guard and Air Force units are playing a major role in the war against Iraq. While many soldiers are overseas, a few are left behind to continue work right here at home. Recruiting plays a major role in the next generation of the military. And with us today is National Guard recruiter Josh Wanner and U.S. Air Force recruiter Brian Myers. Thank you for coming on the show today.
Thank you.
To both of you. Well, first of all, Josh, I'd like to start with you. With the National Guard, what type of a lifestyle does a member of the National Guard lead?
National Guard, we use the term citizen soldier, basically meaning that individual comes into the National Guard as a citizen, whether it's being a full-time student, full-time employee, but then also a soldier doing the 1 week in a month and 2 weeks in the summer as well, too.
Okay, so they have a dual role there.
Yes, they do.
Okay. Now, Brian, the Air Force is a lot different than the National Guard. Could you tell us a little bit about the lifestyle of someone in the Air Force?
Well, absolutely. We are full-time company, full-time pay, full-time job. You get the opportunity to learn one of over 125 jobs in the Air Force. We fully train you, pay you, and get the opportunity also to travel around the world to all the Air Force installations. So it's kind of cool and it's fun, and it's really, I enjoyed it.
Okay. So. Now, Brian, also, your job as a recruiter right now, there's a war going on in Iraq. How has this changed your job as of late?
I can only answer that on the zone. We kind of work in zones. And the zone that I deal with, where I recruit out of my schools in Northwest Minnesota, it's really been really no decrease or increase. Air Force meets its recruiting goals yearly, and it's been pretty steady, which is neat.
Okay. Have you seen many people coming back to reenlist?
I don't handle that. Once they're in the Air Force, they'll go through the military personnel flight to reenlist. We do get a little bit more increase with the prior service individuals who've already served the United States Air Force, and they call up, hey, do you need me? Or I said, no, everything's okay. We got it under control.
Yeah. Okay. Now, what about you, Josh? Is it a similar situation for recruiting right now with you?
It is very similar. With Sergeant Myers, what he said is our prior service market has significantly increased. We have individuals who have served active duty at one point in time in their career, and they're looking at coming back in through the National Guard with our recent deployments, asking what can they do, how can they help us. So we have seen that increase with prior service as well, too.
Okay. Now, you said that, you know, these people who are in the National Guard, they also have a home life, a life in the community. How does that affect a community when there is a large deployment like we've seen?
It affects the community greatly, especially when you look at the smaller towns, the armory that's in that location, business owners, doctors, lawyers, policemen, firemen, all these individuals many times serve National Guard status as well as their normal job. So when these people leave, it leaves a void, not only in the community, but for that business as well, too.
Okay. Brian, once somebody says, okay, I want to join the Air Force, I want to get involved, even if they're doing it right now, how long does it take with the training and everything before they can actually be deployed and go overseas or wherever?
Kind of hard to answer. Probably in the norm, it would be, we have a 6.5 weeks of basic training, which every Air Force member goes to San Antonio, Texas. And then from there, technical training would be within whatever their job is. That can last between 4 to 52 weeks. On average, to hit your training and hit mainstream Air Force, probably 4 to 6 months.
Okay, so
most likely.
So quite a while of training. For some, it might seem like a very quick turnaround before they actually get deployed.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a whole lot of training.
Okay. Now, Josh, for example, going on right now, the National Guard going over and helping in Iraq, What are the sorts of things, you know, we hear lots of the people on the front lines, people going in, even the Air Force, you know, making strikes and things. What about the National Guard? What are more of the traditional roles that they play in a situation?
Generally, for National Guard, any time that we serve in a wartime conflict, especially right now, is we're serving a support role. The Combat Engineer Unit out of Fargo is basically a construction unit. The Quartermaster Detachment here in Grand Forks is water purification, which is all support as well. And then the 957 Engineer Company out of Bismarck is also a support unit as well, too. So we serve a support role. Most of the individuals who have been activated are currently here in the U.S. still. time will tell if they have to actually go overseas, though.
Okay, and you say support role. What are some of the specific things that they would be doing?
When you look at water purification, being in a desert environment, obviously fresh water is at a premium. The water purification unit provides that to soldiers, allowing them the fresh water. Our military runs on food and water, so they are definitely a priority when it comes to any kind of a desert environment or where water is a premium.
Okay. Now, Brian, how is the role of the Air Force? You know, it's a lot different than a support role. Could you explain what happens there?
Well, definitely different from the Air National, Army National Guard. Air power is the main thing the United States Air Force does, and different missions within that. It could be definitely having aircraft deliver their munitions on designated targets, and also humanitarian relief and different things that we do. It's very broad, very wide spectrum.
Okay, and you also said there's many different jobs that happen with that. One last question to you. How do you see the future for your unit as far as recruiting?
Oh, good. Everything's going well, going steady. And as I said before, I can only say from my zone, aspect on that. But good. I'm happy to do it, and I'm looking forward to it. I am finishing up recruiting. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go back to my previous job in the Air Force. Looking forward to do that, too.
All right. Well, good luck to you both on recruiting, and I hope it goes well for you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming today. Many say the Kentucky Derby is the greatest 2 minutes in sports. However, we'll show you the greatest 8 seconds as we take a look into the life of a professional bull rider. Also, teaching with scissors, combs, and colors might sound strange to some, but for one instructor, these are everyday learning tools. That story's next on Studio One.
UND's Conflict Resolution Center is your regional training resource for conflict transformation and prevention. Conflict is inevitable in the business world. Your ability to manage it is key to your success. That's where we can help. We provide on-site training, mediation, and facilitation services customized for your organization. The UND Conflict Resolution Center, capturing the positive energy of conflict and transforming it into human potential.
Why should I go to the University of North Dakota School of Engineering and Mines? Is it the small class sizes and personal attention I'll get from the faculty and staff? Is it the hands-on student projects my friends and I will work on? Is it the professional internship programs that'll help me prepare for my future career? Maybe I just want to be a part of something amazing.
Find out for yourself what makes the UND School of Engineering and Mines the perfect choice for your engineering degree. Call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
Tradition runs deep among American Indian people. One of those traditions is helping others. At the University of North Dakota, Native American Programs is dedicated to helping students succeed. Our support services include tutoring and financial aid assistance. We have more American Indian programs than any other university in the U.S., making UND a leader in Indian education. Be a part of our tradition. Call 1-800-CALL-UND.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota. This is a unique place. A place where you can learn with some of the best technology, where you can talk to the faculty in small class settings, a place where student activity groups enhance your education, a place which offers interaction with the court system, an affordable place where you can gain all the skills you need to get a job. Take your place at the University of North Dakota School of Law. Phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Walt Disney Pictures brings an award-winning book to life in the upcoming film, Holes. The movie portrays Stanley, a boy who seems to be in the wrong place at the wrong times. He tries to overcome a 150-year-old curse that was placed upon his family. He is sent to Camp Green Lake to pay his penance and to build his character. All of the boys at Camp Green Lake are to dig 5 foot deep by 5 foot wide holes as their punishment. One rule they must always follow is never to make the warden mad. Sigourney Weaver plays the two-faced warden who is secretly after a hidden treasure.
It's a place where she grew up, and in fact she had to dig these holes herself. So I don't think she has a lot of compassion for these kids. They're all supposed to be bad boys who got in trouble anyway. So digging holes gives them character.
The script of the movie was written by the author of the book, Holes, that was re-released 3 years ago. Weaver's daughter urged her to play the part of the warden, as Holes is her favorite book. Holes opens nationwide April 18th. Now time to take a look at the events happening in your area. Fashions come and go, then sometimes they come back again. Hairstyles are the same way. Today we spend a day in the life of someone who teaches others to cut hair.
After working with hair for almost 20 years, Miss Desiree went back to school. This time, she is the teacher. She says she can relate to her students in many ways.
I'm going home on the weekends and waking up in the middle of the night with my arms outstretched trying to wrap a perm.
Miss Desiree spends her day teaching classes, checking styles done on mannequins.
So, try to get them more like this here, so fix a couple of them.
And helping students on the salon floor. She says they sometimes get nervous working with clients for the first time.
My first haircut was right behind me on that back wall. She had long, straight blonde hair. It was very thick. And I was so nervous, I cut off just a half an inch, and she gave me a 50-cent tip that, of course, I framed for a couple years and decided I needed a kind of pop one day.
He says it is easy to keep up with the latest trends.
Because if you don't see it in a magazine or if you don't see it on TV, the kids tell you.
One of Miss Desiree's 63 students says that she enjoys her classes.
Instructors are always there to watch and make sure things are going smoothly. If you have a question, they're always there to help you.
Miss Desiree says when she was trying to decide what occupation she wanted, she narrowed it down to three things: a beautician, a nurse, or a teacher. She must have made the right choice because now she says she's all three.
I'm a cosmetologist and I'm also a nurse because you have to bandage up the girls when they cut their fingers. To become a teacher has just been a plus, a big plus.
Most people go back to school to continue their education. Miss Desiree went back to teach others how to do the job she loves. Reporting for Studio One, I'm Lene Rinkenberger.
Miss Desiree says many hairstyles make comebacks. She even commented that the 80s mullet hairstyle for men, of short hair on the side and long hair at the back, is versatile and even sexy. The Earth's natural resources are precious and finite. Many people forget these facts. Later we'll talk to a professor who will tell us what could happen if people are careless with resources. And noise ordinances won't stop them. They are addicted to the sound, the bass, and the look. Coming up, we'll take a look at how addictive one loud hobby can get. That story plus news, sports, and the weather in the next half hour on Studio One.
North Dakota has been home to many successful entrepreneurs. George Bull and his partners found value in farina, the whitest part of wheat, and created cream of wheat. Patrick Haggerty is the founder of one of the nation's high-tech giants, Texas Instruments. And Raymond Rood's product has been used in every Olympic competition since 1960. He is responsible for the modern diving board. Ryan Foltz is the first graduate of the UND Entrepreneurship Program. Are you next?
The University of North Dakota Alumni Association and Foundation, together with thousands of alumni and friends, are making a difference at UND. Thanks to generous private support, many students have experienced the rich history, tradition, and spirit of the University of North Dakota. UND alumni and friends understand the importance of education and are proud to be part of UND's growth and success. Learn how your gift to the UND Foundation can benefit you and your university. You can make a difference.
Let your job experience help you earn a degree in engineering while you continue to work. The University of North Dakota's Distance Engineering Degree Program offers the only ABET-accredited undergraduate degree program at a distance. Instructors and classes are delivered to you through videotape and other technologies.
Allows you to have a class whenever you like.
UND Continuing Education and the School of Engineering and Mines, teaming up to bring quality education to your door.
Are you a parent looking for childcare? Do you know what good childcare looks like? Do you provide childcare and have questions? Does childcare affect your business? Do you have employees who are concerned about child care? Doesn't every child deserve quality child care? Any questions? Call Child Care Resource and Referral.
From the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Yes, thank you for joining us today.
Well, you know, there are a few animals that I would like to pass on, you know, ever taking a ride on. You know, horses, those mm-hmm. are good. Those mm-hmm. are good. Mm-hmm. Bulls, we'll stay away from those. You know, bull riding, yeah. That's just kind of...
You think it'd be kind of scary, huh?
Kind of scary, kind of crazy.
Well, there's some people out there that love to do that stuff.
That is true, that is true.
And we have a story, too, that's
we
coming
do.
Up.
We do. Up in sports, we are going to show a little story about a rodeo that we did take a look at. So mm-hmm. some bull riding.
Right.
Kind of interesting.
Scary stuff. Also coming up in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, the war in Iraq may seem like a world away to some. However, for one man, it can't get any closer to home. We'll hear the story of a man who built bombs for Saddam Hussein.
And a standard car stereo just doesn't cut it for some drivers. They need more. Sometimes they are willing to pay more than what the car is worth. Later, we'll see how people go to extremes to boost a car stereo system.
Also, the United Nations Population Fund says the world population growth is equal to around 3 babies being born every second. That's a lot of people inhabiting the Earth in a short period of time. Coming up, we'll talk to a man who will address the problems of overpopulation in the world today. Before we get to that, here's today's news with Haley Wamstead.
Thanks, Monty and Adria. Air France and British Airways have announced they will both be permanently grounding their Concorde airplanes. The airlines have decided to stop providing this high-speed service due to high maintenance costs and falling revenues. The number of passengers has fallen off considerably since an Air France Concorde crashed near Paris in July of 2000, killing all on board. Tickets for transatlantic flight cost around $10,000 and were usually purchased by wealthy business people and celebrities. British Airways currently has 7 Concordes and Air France has 5. The planes will be grounded in October. Many businesses have begun to feel an economic pinch since the SARS virus first appeared on the Asian continent. Economists have begun to lower growth estimates for many Asian economies in hardest-hit areas by severe acute respiratory syndrome. The sudden emergence of the disease had caused many people to remain at home in fear of getting sick. Those who do venture out of the house are wearing face masks in an attempt to protect themselves. Industries that draw large crowds like airlines, hotels, restaurants, and shopping malls appear to be hardest hit. As U.S. troops battle in Iraq, many countries are staging anti-war demonstrations. In order to protect U.S. students studying abroad, many colleges around the country are advising students to avoid those demonstrations. Colleges are also telling students not to wear clothes that identify themselves as Americans. In fact, many U.S. students are trying to pass themselves off as Canadians, a country that's remaining neutral in this conflict. Schools are doing everything they can to limit the exposure of students in foreign countries by maintaining tight communication with programs overseas. This in turn limits where students are allowed to go and how long they can stay out. Students are also advised to use cell phones and email in order to constantly let the students know where they are. Some universities say that despite all the precautionary tactics, the war has not affected the popularity of study abroad programs. For those who pondered the fate of Saddam Hussein, they are actually able to put money on it. Many internet gambling sites took bets on how long the dictator would last as the leader of Iraq. Sites such as Tradesports.com and BetOnSports.com offered odds on when Saddam would be ousted. Big money is riding on Hussein's fate. More than $1 million is on the line at one website. And as news of the ongoing dictator came in, the odds changed. While many people are placing bets on these sites, experts caution that the system works much like the stock market. People can lose money very quickly. With the war unfolding in Iraq, Americans are learning more and more about how the Iraqi government ruled its people. We talked with one man who knows firsthand how Saddam Hussein ran Iraq. Qadir Hamza was once a high-ranking official in Iraq. He is also one reason the U.S. is at war. In Grand Forks, North Dakota, Hamza came to tell the public why he supports the coalition forces and told of his plans for the future of Iraq. Hamza formerly was the head of Iraq's nuclear weapons program and advisor to Saddam Hussein. He said Iraq does have biological weapons, but says he is unsure if they'll use them or not.
There is doubt that an order to use these weapons will be implemented, because the people who will implement it will face all the might of the U.S.
However, Hamza says the U.S. should still prepare in case they do use such weapons. He predicted that once the coalition forces took Baghdad, the Iraqi people would celebrate freely. He also says once Baghdad is taken, the whole country will fall. Hamza says the Iraqi people would have cooperated earlier with the American soldiers, but they were scared of what the Iraqi forces might do.
They are hopeful. They are waiting for the U.S. to come, but these thugs are preventing them. They are afraid of Saddam people coming back and shooting them. So when that danger is removed, you'll find everything is open and people will welcome the U.S.
Hamza decided to leave Iraq in 1995 because he felt reform had to be made. He met with U.S. officials but could not reveal important information until they brought his family safely to the U.S. Saddam Hussein and his regime had threatened three times to kill Hamza's son if he told the U.S. top secret information. Once his family arrived safely, he cooperated with the U.S. to build their case against Iraq. And for now, Kadir Hamza is just waiting for the war to settle so he and his family can return home safely to help rebuild Iraq. Hamza has many new ideas for the future of Iraq. He says the oil industry should be privatized, and he's pushing for democratic reforms for the Iraqi government. And that's news for today. Monty and Adria?
Thanks a lot, Haley. Well, you know, I opened the trunk of my car the other day, and I noticed my ice scraper in the back.
And it's probably good.
Yeah, I haven't used it for quite a while.
And that's good.
Yeah, it's great.
I'm happy about that. Well, why don't we go check in with Nadine Schrader at the Regional Weather Information Center and see if it can stay in the trunk, your ice scraper.
Well, Monty and Adrian, it looks like you can keep your ice scraper in your trunk as of now. It doesn't look like we're going to see any snow in the future. But before we get to that, let's look at our current conditions in Grand Forks. Currently in Grand Forks, we're sitting at a temperature of 59 degrees, still under sunny skies. And our winds have calmed down just a little bit northwest at 14 miles per hour. Radar has become a key component in our understanding of the weather. It seems that radar data is available almost everywhere you go. For such a widely used tool, you might be surprised on how it was created.
Radar began as an experiment by two United States scientists during the 1930s. Their experiments began after an aircraft interrupted their radio signals. By the end of World War II, radar had been successfully developed not only to locate aircraft, but weather events as well. Since then, radar has changed the face of weather forecasting.
Basically, what they can do, they have really able to see what is like within the thunderstorm itself. So radar went from just seeing what's there, fuzziness on the radar, to being able to see what is really in the storm itself. And that has helped us a lot.
One of the problems that still exists with radar is the Doppler shift. As storms move closer to the radar antenna, it seems as if it is getting stronger, but it is not. We simply see it better because it is closer.
The Doppler shift is similar to a car coming towards you. As it comes towards you, it gets louder and louder until it is parallel with you. Then as it leaves, it decreases in sound. The same holds true with radar and storms.
Radar is more than just measuring rain and snow falling from the sky. Radar can show much more, such as hail and tornado formations and storm structures. The radar network in the United States has well over 100 radars. That makes up the largest radar network in the world. Reporting for Studio One, I'm Brett Snyder.
Currently, the National Severe Storms Laboratory is working to develop a new type of radar. It will help track severe storms earlier than what current radars can do. Doesn't look like our radar is going to be tracking much this weekend, as we are going to see those sunny skies stay throughout Saturday. A couple clouds back in our area on Sunday, and our first chance for a thunderstorm actually this year, it will be on Monday with a high right around 59. You answered your weather IQ question, what does radar stand for? The answer is D, radio detection and ranging. Well, Monty and Adria, it's really surprising that the radar was first used to track planes in World War II, and now it's one of our most popular weather tools.
And how important is radar to weather forecasting?
It's pretty much one of the most essential things that we have, because it's to tell us what's coming into our area and kind of shows us what's going to produce when it comes towards us in our area and type things.
Thank you so much, Nadine.
All right. Well, it's a good thing they have that and they can use those sorts of things. Yeah. Well, let's go now to sports news. And Corey Morlock has that.
Thanks, Monty and Adria. Most people would think that hopping on a bull and trying to ride it for 8 seconds would be crazy. That just happens to be all in a day's work for a rodeo cowboy.
Most rodeo cowboys have loads of stories from all the injuries they've gotten while riding bulls.
I've shattered my forehead right between my eyes.
The worst that I have had happen is I had my neck and my jaw broke at the same time while I was working inside the barrel. A bull had got his hind leg in the barrel with me and couldn't get it out.
Tore my finger off the other day. 9 stitches in that.
But even with all these gruesome injuries, these cowboys keep coming back for more. And what is it that keeps them coming back?
It can pay really good. I mean, depends on what's added and all that good stuff.
But even with the injuries, the cowboys are here to do one thing. Stay on and try to ride a bull for 8 seconds.
Started him pretty good, and I was nice and relaxed, moving real good, and the next thing you know, I started thinking in the middle of the ride, and I second-guessed the bull, and I made a mistake, and he bucked me off.
Sometimes cowboys get noticeable cuts and bruises when they ride. And what do these rodeo stars think when they do get visible injuries?
Well, chicks dig scars. I hope.
Even if his scars don't impress the ladies, Kenny's riding might just do the trick. For Studio One Sports, this is Max Huber.
Many rodeo athletes are on the road for more than 200 days a year. They say it makes relationships hard, but they all have one goal in mind, the national finals in Las Vegas. Prize money for that event totals more than $4 million. Now the answer to this week's Studio and Sports trivia question, what country has won the most World Cups ever? Our answer is D, Brazil. They've won 5, including 1958, 1962, 70, 94, and most recently in 2002. Well, that's the sports for today. Monty and Adria.
Thanks, Corey. Celebrities are sometimes known for having strong opinions about religion, politics, and even war. Later, we'll listen to some of your thoughts on how you respond to celebrities' opinions.
Also, tinted windows, custom rims, and most importantly, the stereo system. No ride is complete without the luxury of great sound. Coming up, we'll see how far some will go to get the best. That story is next on Studio One.
UND's Conflict Resolution Center is your regional training resource for conflict transformation and prevention. Conflict is inevitable in the business world. Your ability to manage it is key to your success. That's where we can help. We provide on-site training, mediation, and facilitation services customized for your organization. The UND Conflict Resolution Center, capturing the positive energy of conflict and transforming it into human potential.
Explore the educational opportunities available through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota. With just one phone call or a click of the mouse, you'll find high-quality programs designed for today's adults. We have a large selection of continuing education courses that are available at a time and place that's convenient for you. Discover a world of learning through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
You're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks.
Everyone has their own opinion about the war, including celebrities. The lead singer of the popular country group, the Dixie Chicks, went as far as saying that she was embarrassed that President Bush was from Texas. Comedian Dennis Miller appeared on The Tonight Show and commented on his support for the war. Celebrities have been using fame as a platform for expressing their strong political viewpoints. We wanted your thoughts on the subject.
Good because they can get their message out there and they can say what they want to say because they'll be noticed and you can hear it, but some people tend to say too much, I think, and they should just kind of watch what they say.
Just because they're famous and they make a lot of money doesn't give them any authority to have an opinion on political matters.
I believe they have a right to do this, but I think people on the other end that are listening to their opinions should take it with a grain of salt and not put any more weight in their opinion than on their own opinion or anybody else that they respect.
If you have an easy way to voice your opinion, then they should use that for whatever they believe.
I don't think they should express their viewpoints at all politically. I think they're entertainers and that's all they should do is entertain. I think they should leave their political beliefs out of it.
Spring is here and many activities are getting restarted after a cold winter. One of them can be loud and enjoyable. You might actually hear it while you're driving around town.
Danny Raymond has a new car, but the car is not complete without something else. Danny has to have great sound in his vehicle.
A lot of people don't think it is worth it, but I don't know, I really enjoy the sound of it and listening to music, I guess, in it.
It is an expensive hobby. To have a complete system like Danny, you need to spend about $2,500. Those that sell the stereo system say all ages of people are interested in car audio systems. Some people spend even more money on their system than their car.
You know, you can barely push them in here. You know, maybe you could get $1,500 out of them, and people will actually spend, you know, over $1,500 on the system for that vehicle. And you know, if the car works and they're happy with it and they're a car audio fanatic, that's fine, you know.
Danny says his sound system influences the way he drives.
I don't try speed as much anymore, but sometimes, yeah, you do have a tendency to speed when you listen to some music, I guess. But you can't turn it up too loud because you'll start to blow speakers and ruin your equipment, so you start. You gotta take a little bit of care of it. You gotta know what you're doing, I guess, when you're listening to it.
The disadvantage to having all this equipment in the car is that you lose trunk space.
Yeah, I took this to a camping trip last summer with four people, and all our stuff was it. We just put it in another vehicle, so we ended up having to take two vehicles because of it. So that was a bad part.
After spending a lot of money on car audio, Danny says he will be working to pay off his music-making debt. I'm Frode Tilde Norby, reporting for Studio One.
Danny says the stereo hobby is addicting. He is always looking for new additions. He says the next step is satellite radio and a DVD player for his car. It's estimated that there are 6 billion people in the world today. Every one of those people needs the essentials in life, like food, water, and shelter. Those essentials come from the Earth's resources. Next, we'll talk to a man who will talk about some problems the Earth is having when dealing with that many people.
The University of North Dakota Alumni Association and Foundation, together with thousands of alumni and friends, are making a difference at UND. Thanks to generous private support, many students have experienced the rich history, tradition, and spirit of the University of North Dakota. UND alumni and friends understand the importance of education and are proud to be part of UND's growth and success. Learn how your gift to the UND Foundation can benefit you and your university. You can make a difference.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business with skills to enhance your workforce retention and productivity efforts. The UND Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in conducting employee satisfaction research, workforce needs assessments, and the development of customized training materials. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota. This is a unique place, a place where you can learn with some of the best technology, where you can talk to the faculty in small class settings, a place where student activity groups enhance your education, a place which offers interaction with the court system, an affordable place where you can gain all the skills you need to get a job. Take your place at the University of North Dakota School of Law. Phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Why should I go to the University of North Dakota School of Engineering and Mines? Is it the small class sizes and personal attention I'll get from the faculty and staff? Is it the hands-on student projects my friends and I will work on? Is it the professional internship programs that'll help me prepare for my future career? Maybe I just want to be a part of something amazing.
Find out for yourself what makes the UND School of Engineering and Mines the perfect choice for your engineering degree. Call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
The Graduate School at the University of North Dakota is the premier graduate school of the Northern Great Plains, offering advanced degrees in more than 50 fields of study. Our innovative and flexible programs give full-time students, as well as working professionals, the opportunity to study under the guidance of nationally and internationally recognized faculty. Advance your career with a master's or doctoral degree from the Graduate School at the University of North Dakota.
The World Population Balance Organization reports the Earth is adding more than 200,000 people every day. That works out to be more than 75 million more people every year, or about the same as the combined populations of California, Texas, and New York. Some say we must stabilize populations soon for the good of future generations. Geology professor Dexter Perkins is here to discuss the concerns of overpopulation. Thanks so much for coming on today.
Sure.
First of all, why is population such an important topic?
Well, the population of the world's more than doubled in my lifetime, and that means we're using twice as much resources, and there's many resources now that are becoming limited in supply, and eventually we're going to start running out of very, very important stuff.
Uh-huh. What exactly is overpopulation?
Well, I guess at the basic level it means too many people, but population really has two parts to it. One is how many people there are, and there's plenty of places in the world, especially China or India or parts of Africa, which are very crowded with too many people. But it also means individuals just using too much stuff, like we do in the United States. And by many people's measures, the United States is the most overpopulated country in the world because we use most of the resources and create most of the pollution.
Mm-hmm. And how fast is population growing, usually?
Well, right now the doubling rate, the world population is doubling about every 40 years.
Wow.
If it continues the way it is. So we have 6 billion now, and if it goes at the same rate, we'll have 12 billion in another 40 years.
That's a lot of people.
That's a lot of people.
And what parts, are there parts that are growing faster than other parts? Or are there parts that are just not growing at all?
Well, it usually correlates with the wealth of the people. And so the lesser developed countries with poorer people are growing quite rapidly. That includes parts of Africa, South America, some of the Asian countries, and then the more developed countries, Western Europe, United States, Canada, are growing at a much slower rate or not growing at all. I think Germany and some of the other countries in Northern Europe are actually declining in population right now.
Mm-hmm. And if modern technology were to improve, could that help at all with our overpopulation need?
There's a certain group of people that believe we can solve everything by technology. I'm a little skeptical. I mean, at some point you have so many people that the technological fixes just won't be able to keep up with the problems that you create.
Mm-hmm.
And also technology involves using resources, and at some point many of these resources are going to become exhausted.
Mm-hmm. And you talk about resources. A lot of people sometimes even think that they're finite resources. They will never go away. What about water resources and things like that? Could we use the ocean and things like that to, if we ever run out of water?
Well, water is a really good example where technology has actually made some differences. There's plenty of places in the Middle East and then more recently in Western U.S. and California where they're actually using ocean water. And they take the salt out to create fresh water supplies. And so there is, if you're willing to pay the money, quite a lot of water that could come from the oceans and supply human needs. But traditionally, we just haven't used it. other resources that are dwindling, though, such as energy resources. We don't, at least we don't know of any substitutes for the current energy sources we're using. And those could really run out, and, you know, who knows when it's going to happen, but it will happen.
And I've heard of the maybe the possibility of sending humans up to space and things like that if we do become overpopulated here on Earth. What do you think about that possibility? Is that in the works? Do you think it could happen?
Sounds like science fiction to me. I don't think it's very likely.
No, not very likely. Yeah. And what advice would you give to people who are concerned about overpopulation and maybe want to help help with that problem in some way?
Well, certainly here in United States, North America, the number one thing we can do is live a simpler life and not be such great consumers. We produce more of the world's pollution than any other country. We should not be doing that, and the only way to do that is to live a simpler life. And I think if you're concerned about population, that's the first thing you should do. Ride your bike to work and do everything you can to save energy resources, and that would be a great start.
Okay, well, thank you so much for sharing your information with us today.
Sure.
You're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota. We'll be right back after this.
Tradition runs deep among American Indian people. One of those traditions is helping others. At the University of North Dakota, Native American Programs is dedicated to helping students succeed. Our support services include tutoring and financial aid assistance. We have more American Indian programs than any other university in the U.S., making UND a leader in Indian education. Be a part of our tradition. Call 1-800-CALL-UND.
Let your job experience help you earn a degree in engineering while you continue to work. The University of North Dakota's Distance Engineering Degree Program offers the only ABET-accredited undergraduate degree program at a distance. Instructors and classes are delivered to you through videotape and other technologies.
Allows you to have a class whenever you like.
UND Continuing Education and the School of Engineering and Mines, teaming up to bring quality education to your door.
At UND Aerospace, let your future take flight. Plan your education in the most technologically advanced collegiate and contract aerospace training environment on the planet. Graduates work for top agencies and fly for every major airline nationwide. Study on campus, via distance learning, or at any of our facilities, and you'll be where the aviation industry leaders of tomorrow are today. UND Aerospace at the University of North Dakota, Grand Forks.
Are you a parent looking for childcare? Do you know what good childcare looks like? Do you provide childcare and have questions? Does childcare affect your business? Do you have employees who are concerned about childcare? Doesn't every child deserve quality childcare? Any questions? Call Childcare Resource and Referral.
Valor Insurance partners with you in protecting what matters most. For more than 50 years, Valor has built its reputation on its people, its clients, and a commitment to VIP service. Valor Insurance, Fargo, Bismarck, Grand Forks. Valor Insurance understands that the strength of its people is its greatest asset. People that tailor insurance protection that meets your needs. That's the key to VIP service. Valor Insurance, Fargo, Bismarck, Grand Forks.
Tune in next week on Studio One. We'll be giving you some great recipe ideas from our old friend, Chef Kim Holmes. We'll see how you can turn ordinary ham and potatoes into a great Easter dinner. Plus, we'll have other news and entertainment stories for you.
We're going to leave you with some pictures now of bingo fanatics, courtesy of photographer Troy Clifton. From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.